Amen. Thank you to those who have led us so well in worship this evening. As we now turn our attention to the Word of God, I have to tell you that I have lots of conversations about sin. It comes with the pastoral territory. And when I have conversations about sin, these conversations typically come from two extremes. On one hand, is the person so devastated by their own personal sin that they feel unloved and unforgivable. That's on one hand, but on the other hand of that extreme is the person who should be devastated by their own personal sin, but is not. And therefore, they feel no need to change and continue their passionate pursuit of sin. These two extremes have led us to a Sunday night series on Romans chapter 6 that we have titled Dead to Sin. If you would join me once again in Romans chapter 6, tonight we will read the first seven verses. Romans chapter 6. If you're headed there, can I hear a big, loud amen? And I know, after we've had the little kids sing, the highlight of the service is over. So what I ask is for a lot of amens, and I'll keep moving very quickly. Lack of amens, and I will grind to a halt. That's the deal. Amen. Amen indeed. Romans chapter 6. If you're ready for the Word of God, give me a big loud amen. Amen. The question is asked, Romans 6 verse 1, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? Here comes the answer. By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, that we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Amen. Last time that we were here on a Sunday evening, gathered around Romans chapter 6, we focused on baptism. The theological truth and the spiritual reality for those of us who have been baptized, we were baptized into Jesus' death and his resurrection. That in our baptism, we were actually united with Jesus in his death and in his resurrection. Last time we gathered around Romans chapter 6, we looked at the powerful symbol of baptism. And now in our next two Sunday nights gathered around Romans chapter 6, we slow it down a bit and we look at death and resurrection. Tonight our focus is on death. And I've got three quick words for you, assuming I get lots of amens. And here's the first. As Christians, as people of faith, we are dead to the old. We see this phrase, that the old way, that the old life is dead. We see that phrase repeated throughout those verses that we read moments ago from Romans chapter 6. For those of you of faith, for those of you who have claimed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, when you became a follower of Jesus, the old you died. And Romans chapter 6 says that the funeral for the old you actually took place in your baptism. That your baptism was the funeral service for the old you. As you symbolically united with Jesus in his death and were raised to walk a new life in Christ. The old is gone, and the new is here. The old you is gone, and the Christ-like you is here.
Amen.
Yeah, yeah. Amen indeed. But right? Isn't that true? Oh, maybe. Hopefully it's true. How have you grown more like Christ in the past week? When I ask questions like that, people go, oh, Pastor, that's not fair. This has been a rough week. Okay, granted. It was a rough week for me too. I probably wouldn't do well on that question either. Yeah, how have you grown more like Christ in the last month? Still tough? Last 2 months, 3 months, last 6 months. I'll give you 6 months. How have you grown more like Christ in the last 6 months? Hopefully we've got an answer there. A significant answer. Last year? And I ask the question, not to make you feel guilty or to cause any condemnation. According to Romans chapter 8, verse 1, for those of you in Christ, there is no condemnation. So I don't pose the question to produce guilt or condemnation. I pose the question to awaken us to our Christian call. That as Christians, we are dead to the old. The funeral was held at our baptism. And we now walk in the newness of life provided by Christ Jesus. So we're dead to the old. We got through that very quickly. Two, we're also dead to the world. But far too many Christians claim the name of Christ but look just like the world. Well, the New Testament tells us that as Christians in this new life in Christ, that we are to be light shining in darkness. That we are to be the bearers and carriers of good news in a world filled with doom and gloom. But as Christians, we still live in the world. The things of the world are constantly before our eyes. The things of this world weigh heavy upon our shoulders. And that's why the Scripture constantly tells us that the old you is dead. And now, as you face every day with new life in Christ, with the world in front of you, and the world weighing heavy on your shoulders, we must break the patterns of this world. Romans 12, 1 and 2, you'll see this on the screen. Romans 12, 1 and 2 tells us, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. If there's a question I hear as a pastor more than any other, it is one-on-one conversations with followers of Jesus Christ seeking to know God's will. First step in knowing God's will is to shatter the patterns of this world. As we put the old in the ground, as we shatter the patterns of this world, our eyes are opened to the will of God, which is right in front of us. Well, we think that the world is in front of us, and it is, but the scripture would tell us so is the will of God. We're dead to the world, which leads me to my third and final point for us as Christians. Yes, dead to the old. Yes, dead to the world, but also dead to sin. This is the whole conversation of Romans chapter 6. The beginning of the chapter is opened up with the question, what shall we do then? Right? If God gives grace, if He forgives us, if God is so quick to give out forgiveness, if God is so quick to cover us with grace, why don't we just sin more so that there'll be more grace? Paul says, by no means, absolutely not. He said, that thinking is foolish. Because remember, when you were baptized, you actually united with Jesus in His death and in His resurrection. You died to the old. You broke the patterns of this world. And you said no to the ways of sin. And you've said yes to the ways of your Savior. Far too many people. It's not new. It's here in Romans chapter 6. Far too many people have attempted to live in sin, presuming that grace will just cover them. Pastor and theologian of days gone by, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, referred to this as cheap grace. Grace without confession, grace without repentance, grace without obedience. Cheap grace. And Bonhoeffer has went as far as to say that cheap grace is the enemy of the church. I would tend to agree with that sentiment. Just like the people in Paul's day who posed the question, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? We too need a deeper reflection upon grace. Amen. John Newton, the hymn writer, taught us about the biblical notion of grace in the hymn that we love so well, Amazing Grace. The first stanza, known by churchgoers and non-churchgoers alike, says, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. We, that's you, and that's me, we are wretches saved by grace. yet. We must not continue to live in a state of wretchedness. Just assuming that grace covers it all. One should not find home and then return to being lost. One should not receive sight and then go back to blindness. It's the words of Amazing Grace. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was once blind, and now I see. You don't find home and then go get lost again. You don't receive sight and then return to blindness. One who is saved from wretchedness doesn't return to wretchedness. Now imagine if John Newton, the hymn writer, posed a second verse of Amazing Grace, which spoke of the desire to sin because he had been covered by Amazing Grace. I thought of this experiment a number of years ago. I was at a different church at that time. I was in my office writing a sermon. I go, what if John Newton had written a different stanza, that the second verse was a desire to sin? So I left my office, and I went to the next office, and I went to my music minister at that previous church, Sam Johnson. I said, Sam, I need this for a sermon illustration. You've got 20 minutes. Write for me a heretical verse that follows the first stanza of Amazing Grace. He gives me bug eyes. He goes, you want me to do what? And I go, just listen, right? Just listen, and I need this quick. First stanza of Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. I said, write a second stanza that speaks of a desire to sin because you've been saved by Amazing Grace. 20 minutes later, Sam knocks on my door, and he lays this on my desk. So first stanza, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Sam penned this heretical second verse. Once chained and burdened by the law, I now live free in grace. I now may sin, no more condemned to fully feel God's grace. Sam did a wonderful job pinning those lyrics, but that notion is completely foreign to the New Testament. Saved by grace, yes. Saved by grace, absolutely. Saved by grace, fully. But when we are baptized, we celebrate the death of the old. We shatter the patterns of the world. We say no to sin, and we say yes to our Savior. As Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 puts it, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. We're almost done here, but I know how this goes. I have been at this pastoring task long enough. You preach a sermon like this, or you have this conversation across a table, and the first response is, but preacher, it's so hard. Preacher, you just don't know. You don't know how hard it is. It's incredibly hard. It is extremely hard to put away the old, to break the patterns of this world. It is so hard to say no to sin. And I would agree with you for about a half second. And then I would respond with Romans 8:11. It says, "And if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of His Spirit who lives in you." That if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And you say, "Preacher, it's too hard to say no to sin." Yes, it is too hard for you. But thank God. Thank God that the Holy Spirit lives in you, who desires for you to say no to sin and follow your Savior. But preacher, it's too hard. It's too hard for you, but not the Spirit. So a quick sprint to the finish. If you were here in a previous week in the series, we went through this. Well, how do we go about this? How do we actually say no to sin? Well, first we have to acknowledge sin. We have to acknowledge that in this world there's the will of man and there is the will of God. That there is your will and there is the will of God. We have to acknowledge the presence of sin. That's the spiritual reality. You study the will of man by looking in your own heart. You come to know the will of God by studying the Scriptures. At first, we have to acknowledge the presence of sin in the world and sin in our lives. That acknowledgement of sin is followed by the confession of sin. That we as Christians should be the first to acknowledge when we fall short of the glory of God. We should be the first. Far too often we've fallen prey to the lie that if we're spiritually mature, we act as if we have everything put together. But as Christians, we should be the first. I should be the first to acknowledge and confess my own sin. So our acknowledgement of sin and our confession of sin is followed by repentance of sin. What good is an acknowledgement and a confession of sin if we don't repent from it? Once we confess it, we repent of it. We say, "No more." It's our repentance. It takes full responsibility of our sin. We recognize that it damages our relationships with others and it damages our relationship with God. We repent of it. And then finally, we take that sin to the cross. We take our sin to the cross. Upon that cross where Jesus died for the sins of the world. And when we take that sin to the cross, the New Testament explains to us that we find forgiveness, we find peace, we find strength, we find hope. That comes through the empty tomb, where Jesus not only died for our sin, but He rose from the dead to give us life. As Christians, as people of faith, as followers of Jesus, we are dead to the old. We are dead to the world. We've said no to sin, and we've been raised to new life. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I'm thankful for the beauty, truth, and power of the gospel. That we have a Savior, His name is Jesus, and He died on the cross for our sins, and He rose from the dead to give us life. And that is not just a true story that impacted us at our day of conversion, but that is a true story that gives life and purpose to every single day. As people gathered in a church service on a Sunday night, may we say no to sin, and may we say yes to our Savior. May we keep the old in the grave, and may we grow in Christ likeness. Father, some of us are getting it right in many ways. We pray for perseverance. We pray for endurance. Father, some of us, we're getting it wrong in many ways. Give us strength. Give us guidance to return to you. And Father, wherever we may be on our spiritual journey, we are so thankful that it is not up to us. That our relationship with you, our forgiveness, our salvation is not dependent on our ability to get our act together. We are so thankful that we have abundant life and eternal life through the completed and sufficient work of Jesus. I pray that we would trust in it tonight. That we would stop pursuing our own passions and desires, that we would stop seeking the ways of this world, and that we would trust and rest in you. Father, I pray for every person seated in this sanctuary, that right now in this moment, by your grace and in your power, that you would overwhelm us with your love for us, that you would overwhelm us with your grace and your mercy and your forgiveness. I pray that you would fill us now with the hope that comes from the gospel. May we stand upon your promise. May we trust in your character. We pray these things, thankful that you hear the prayers of broken people. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.